Okay, so should I begin?
Let me first introduce. So it's great pleasure to have Toto Milanov. He's not us, but towards the hero of the Varnier equation and the Gromov fitting theory.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction and for organizing this event. So let me start. I'm going to write down during the lectures, but just in the beginning, I just want to say some general words, just trying to convey what I'll be talking about these lectures and what I'm not going to be talking about. So the main object in my lectures would be a semi-simple Frobenius manifold. And if you have a semi-simple Frobenius manifold, then there is a general construction due to Dubrovin and Zhang, but which was also somewhat simplified by Buryak, Postuma, and Shadrin. And this construction yields some infinite system of Hamiltonian PDEs, which is an integrable hierarchy of similar to the KdV hierarchy, the same form. Yeah. And the question that I'm working on is this integrable hierarchies also have the notion of a tau function, and the problem is motivated by the work of Mikio Sato and his students, that in the example of KP hierarchy, they prove that the set of tau functions is parameterized by some infinite Grassmannian. The description of this Grassmannian is given in terms of Hirota bilinear equations. So in some sense, what I'm trying to do is to understand whether these hierarchies have the same kind of description. And this the motivation actually here, the main application of this theory would be to compute Gromov-Witten invariants. Let me tell you what I know about this problem that I'm working on. So first of all, I want to specialize to work not with all semi-simple Frobenius manifolds, but with some class of semi-simple Frobenius manifolds that have an integral structure. And I'll gradually come to the definition of integral structure in my lectures. But for now, you can think this is this integral structure simply means that the tangent space, each tangent space of our manifold will be equipped with a lattice. And inside this lattice, there is some set of reflection vectors. So the lattice is equipped also with a pairing here. These structures, the lattice and the set of reflection vectors, they satisfy all axioms of a root system, except that the pairing might be positive definite. It's not positive definite in general. It might be even degenerate. But anyways, we can think of them as generalized root systems. And now, here in red is the part that I'm not going to discuss in my lectures. This is something that I discovered in collaboration with Boško Bakalov. And actually, not that we discovered, but we expect that this is what would happen in general. So here from the lattice, one can construct the so-called lattice vertex operator algebra. Actually, I think that here I have a typo. Here it should be z to the minus. Okay, let me fix it. This should be the symmetric algebra with z to the minus one, z minus one. So I have to make this space infinite dimensional. In this lattice vertex algebra, in general, we'll have to, this is the part that we don't understand very well. In general, one has to find the completion of this lattice vertex algebra. So in some sense here, we are working with polynomial functions on this vector space, and one has to allow more general functions. The problem is to find an element omega in V lambda tensor V lambda, satisfying this kind of equation. And for people who are familiar with W algebras, this looks very similar to the definition of a W algebra by screening operators. And this is the problem that we figure out that we have to solve in it's in the settings of lattice vertex algebras. We know what the solution is here if lambda is the lattice of type ADE, the root system of type ADE. And beyond that, I think some new ideas are necessary to see how to solve this problem. Actually, there are some new ideas that come from quiver gauge theories, especially the work of Kimura and Pestun. But so far, I didn't really work very hard in this direction. So I don't know currently what can be said beyond the case of AD singularities. So this is the picture that is supposed to give us the Hirota quadratic equations. At least this is how the Hirota quadratic equation comes in the case the lattice is of AD type. And now here the left part here is this is what I want to explain in my lectures. Out of this Frobenius manifold, Giventhal introduced some higher genus reconstruction formalism. It's some quantization formalism which produces some generating function called total descendant potential in some Fock space. This means the Fock space is some kind of a completion of the space of holomorphic functions on this vector space. He also introduced certain set of vertex operators that are that depend. Actually, the vertex operators could be defined for any vector in the tangent space, but especially the ones that correspond to reflection vectors are very important. And now this is what we observed with Boshko Bakalov is that in fact you can consider a map from the lattice vertex algebra to operators on this Fock space, which to e to the alpha. So here C of lambda is the group algebra of this lattice, and the elements in the group algebra, they look like linear combinations of e to the alpha, right, formal linear combinations. And then we notice that you can construct such a map. So you can extend this map that associates to E alpha, the vertex operator, to a representation of the lattice vertex algebra on the Fock space. And then if you have such an element that satisfies these screening equations, then our expectation is that it's going to produce Hirota quadratic equations. And now what I want to explain in my lectures is I want to explain all these constructions. First, the Giventhal quantization formalism, then these vertex operators, and I want to explain their properties which allow you easily, if you know the Hirota quadratic equations, to prove indeed this statement that the total descendant potential satisfies the Hirota quadratic equations. So the first four lectures of will be dedicated to this kind of general constructions and their general properties. And then in the last lecture, I want to explain how this works in a specific example, namely the case when the lattice is of type AN. Now let me, on the next slide, let me explain also what I currently, what's the, so this is a big project. So what is the current progress in this project? So there are two main examples of a Frobenius manifold. One comes from quantum cohomology of an Orbi fold. And the other example comes from singularity theory. And this is what Kyoji Saito constructed a long time ago. And it's he called it flat structure. And now sometimes these two constructions are equivalent due to some mirror symmetry phenomena. So now if you start with the examples from quantum cohomology, then The beginning, actually, of the entire story is the case when x is a point. This is the famous Witten conjecture proved by Kontsevich. And then the next target for which we know that this project works is when you have an orbifold projective line with such that the orbifold Euler characteristic is positive. And in this case, we know that the corresponding hierarchies are some extended Kazuo-Kimoto hierarchies. And actually, even in this case, the extension is not completely known. So it turns out that such orbifolds are classified by the ADE Dinking diagrams. And in the case of the exceptional Dinking diagrams of type E, the extension is still not known. And then if you consider the case of orbifold Euler characteristic less or equal than zero, then we don't know how this project works. And the only thing that I expect is that one should get something related to the generalized Katz-Moody-Lie algebras. And the case when the dimension of the target is more than one, it's really, I don't know anything in this direction. I think that even the representation theory seems to be, this case seems to be out of reach of the current representation theory. So it looks to me that some new ideas are necessary. So for example, if you take X to be P2, then if you can describe these integrable hierarchies of Dubrovin and Zhang for P2, I think this would be some kind of a breakthrough in this business. And in the case of singularity theory, then everything works very, very nicely for ADE singularities, for simple singularities. And the next case on the list is the case of simple elliptic singularities, which by mirror symmetry are equivalent to the case 2 in Gromov-Witten theory when the orbifold Euler characteristic is zero. And here I think we expect that this project should be doable. So probably this is the next thing on the list to be done, I guess. Okay, so I think these are the general words that I wanted to say. Maybe I should pause just for a couple of seconds if someone wants to ask something or has a comment. Okay, so then let me move to the first lecture for today. So in my first lecture, I want to give some background on Frobenius manifolds. I think that this topic is known by many people, but let me just, at least I want to fix the notation. So today I want to spend my time on some background. So let me start with the definition. So suppose that M is a complex manifold and tau of M would denote the sheaf of holomorphic vector fields. Let me consider the following data. So part A of the data would be for every point T in M, we have a commutative product which would be called Frobenius multiplication. And I'll denote it this way. So it defines a map from here to here. So I'll denote it with a dot and sometimes with index t if I want to emphasize that I'm working, that the product depends on t. So you have such a commutative multiplication on each tangent space and a non-degenerate symmetric bilinear pairing. Such that both the product and the pairing depend holomorphically on T. And they satisfy the Frobenius property, namely that V1 product W pairing with V2 equals V1 W V2 for every vector fields V and O V2 and W. Okay. And this means that each tangent space is a Frobenius algebra. And part B of the data, we have a vector field which is called unit vector field. And this unit vector field, it's a global holomorphic vector field on our manifold, such that it's a unit for the multiplication. So U times V is V for every vector field. And also the second condition that it's flat with respect to the Levi-Civita connection. So here, del Levi-Civita, this is the Levi-Civita connection of the pairing. Levi-Civita connection of the pairing. And finally, the last piece of data that I need is what is called Euler vector field. This is again a global holomorphic vector field such that it essentially says that the lead derivative of the pairing with respect to E is homogeneous of degree 2 minus D. So the lead derivative is 2 minus D times the pairing. So, but in details, this means it can be written in the following way. So, yeah, actually, let me write it on a new page. So if you differentiate E, V1, V2, so V1 and V2 here will be holomorphic vector field. So the pairing of V1 and V2 will be a holomorphic function on M. Right. And this is equal to 2 minus D times the pairing of V1 and V2 for every holomorphic vector fields V1 and V2 and for some constant D. So this constant is uniquely fixed. It is the same for all such vector fields V1 and V2. And this is the data that we have. So the data again is, let me review it. So it's the structure of a Frobenius algebra on each tangent space, a unit vector field, and Euler vector field. And now, given this structure, we define structure connection. Structure connection, sometimes it's called Dubrovin connection. Dubrovin connection on the following vector bundle, Tm times C star to M times C star. Well, this is a vector bundle. So this is a vector bundle on M times C star. So T of M times C star is the total space of this vector bundle. The fiber of this vector bundle at some point Tz is just the tangent space T. It's the tangent space of M at the point T, right? So here the map is on the C factor is just the identity map, and T of M to M is just the standard projection. This vector bundle is defined. So the connection on this the structure connection is defined by the following formulas. Del V is, so it's some kind of deformation of the Levi-Civita connection. So this is for every V holomorphic vector field. This term here, V product, denotes an endomorphism of the sheaf tau M, which is given by Frobenius multiplication by the vector field V. Then in the Z direction, the connection is defined by TdZ minus Z inverse theta plus Z to the minus 2. And here the operator is Frobenius multiplication by the Euler vector field. And now this theta here, so theta is an endomorphism of the tangent sheaf, of the tangent bundle, is defined by theta V equals the covariant derivative of the Euler vector field minus 1 minus d over 2 v. And this is called grading operator. This theta is called grading operator. Okay, and now we can define a Frobenius manifold in the following way. So the data of the multiplication, the pairing, the unit vector field, and the Euler vector field is said to be a Frobenius structure on M of conformal dimension D if the structure connection is flat. Uh, And now, so this is the definition. Maybe I should pause also for a couple of seconds if someone has a question. Okay, and this definition is due to De Bruyne. So he gave a differential geometric interpretation of the properties of quantum cohomology. Okay. So then, next, let me list some very basic properties of a Frobenius manifold that are straightforward to verify from the definitions. So properties. So suppose that we have a Frobenius manifold. Is a Frobenius manifold. Then we have the following properties. Well, the first property is that that the Levi-Civita connection is flat. Is flat. This means that that locally you can always locally there exist coordinates such that well the. The pairing, the bilinear pairing in these coordinates so all these pairings are constants independent of T. And so the flatness of the structure connection immediately implies the flatness of the Levi-Civita connection. The property B is that the grading operator is Q-symmetric. Is Q-symmetric. In other words, theta V1 pairing V2 plus V1 theta V2 is equal to zero for any two holomorphic vector fields. And the last property that I want to mention is that the grading operator theta is covariantly constant. In other words, if you choose flat coordinates, in flat coordinates. T1, Tn, if you write the grading operator, right, so the matrix of the grading operator, then theta AB are constants independent. Independent of T. Okay, so these are the first properties of the Frobenius manifold. There are many others, but for now they're not important for me. So next I want to to give an example, actually the main example where this notion of Frobenius manifold came from, namely Gromov-Witten theory. I don't really need actually to Gromov-Witten theory in my lectures that much, but nevertheless, I think that if you don't know this example from Gromov-Witten theory, many things look strange. So that's why I decided to include this example in my lectures. So suppose a text is a smooth projective variety. Projective variety, and for simplicity, we'll assume that the odd cohomology of X is zero. Otherwise, we have to talk about super Frobenius manifolds, which is done in the book of Mannion. But I think that we don't need this case actually. So now, if you have let me introduce again, fix some set of data for this smooth projective variety. The first set is, let me just look for my note something. Could write it like that. So first I want to choose a set. This is a set of ample line bundles such that their first Chern classes give a Z basis of what is called Picard lattice. So it's this group H2 of X Z. The elements of H2A X Z that are of Hodge type H11, of type 1-1. So this is called Picard lattice. So first we fix such line bundles. The next object is the so-called effective curve cone. So let me denote it with this. So this is it's a cone inside H2 of X Z. So it's a cone generated by such cohomology classes where phi from C to X is a holomorphic map and C is an algebraic curve. In other words, these are homology classes that can be represented with the fundamental classes of algebraic curves in X, in our manifold X. And let me also fix formal variables. They're called Novikov variables. You know them with QI. Their number is the same as the number of these ample line bundles. And we use the following notation. Q to the D would denote K Q1 to the pairing of D with P1, etc. QR D with PR, where D is an effective curve class. Right. And by the way, this property that we chose ample line bundles implies that all these powers are non-negative integers. Right. So if you choose the Novikov variables to correspond to ample line bundles, then you'll have in non-negative integer powers. And then let us also, so finally, let us fix a basis of the cohomology of our manifold of the following form. So with phi 1, I denote the unit in the cohomology. Then phi I plus 1 would be the first term classes of the ample line bundles. So this is for I from 1 to R. And then the remaining, and then you complete this to a homogeneous basis in an arbitrary way. So the next class here would be with index R plus 2, etc. phi n. And let T1 up to Tn be the linear coordinates, the corresponding linear coordinates. On the cohomology, on the vector space underlying the cohomology. So this is the some preliminary notations, and then the main object in Gromov-Witten theory is what is called a stable map. So let me explain what is a stable map. A stable map is a collection, is the following data. Let me write it C, Z1 up to Zn, F. So here C is a nodal Riemann surface. So it's an algebraic curve, possibly singular, but the singularities are at most nodes, nodal Riemann surface. Z1 up to Zn, these are so-called marked points. Which means that they should be non-singular, so non-singular points on C. Such that they're pairwise distinct. And finally, F from C to X is a holomorphic map. Holomorphic map such that such that the automorphism group of this data is finite. So automorphism means a biholomorphism of C that keeps the mark point fixed and is compatible with the map F. So that's what an automorphism is. And we call this a stable map. And if you have any biholomorphism of C, you can easily construct a new stable map. You simply apply this biholomorphism to to the mark points to produce new mark points and compose the map F with the bihomomorphism, right? But we are going to consider such easy way to produce new stable maps as equivalent, and then we're interested in the equivalence classes of stable maps. And this space is denoted, it's the moduli, it's called the moduli space. So let me denote it this way. So it means a set of stable maps. So this is a stable map. Such that C is the genus of C. C is a genus G. This means maybe I should write it this way. To be precise, I should write C has arithmetic genus. Arithmetic genus G, which means that if you take the normalization of this curve, so then you obtain a nullness, non-singular Riemann surface, and you want, so you want the genus of the normalization to be G. Then the other thing that we want is we want that the image of the fundamental class of C to be D. Right, so here D is an effective curve class. Maybe I should put here that D is an effective curve class. And then you have to quotient by equivalence relation. So two stable maps, if they are equivalent, then they should be identified. And maybe this is the place to say that one can study the deformation theory of a stable map, and then it turns out that a stable map has a universal deformation, and this allows you to prove that remark that locally the moduli space is a quotient of a complex space by a finite group. So in some sense you have to consider some, in order to study the geometry of these moduli spaces, you have to consider a generalization of the notion of a orbifold in which the local model is allowed to be quotient of some possibly singular analytic variety by a finite group. Okay, but this point is not important in my lectures. Now once you have these moduli spaces, then we can define also a set of line bundles. So actually these are orbifold line bundles whose fiber at a point, so if I have a stable map, is just the cotangent line at the ith mark point. And when we take the first Chern class of this line bundle, we will obtain some cohomology class on MGN bar XD. And another source of cohomology classes on the moduli space is given by the evaluation maps. So the evaluation map, if you have a stable map, then it simply evaluates at the ith mark point. Okay, and then the next ingredient, and this is actually the most difficult part in Vrom-Witten theory, is the construction of a virtual fundamental cycle. So usually it's denoted with in this way. So it's an element in the homology of our moduli space with rational coefficients. Now the degree of this cohomology, the degree of the virtual fundamental cycle, is, let me write it this way, twice 3g minus 3 plus n plus d times 1 minus g plus the pairing of c1 tx with the degree. And now these terms here in the formula, they have the following explanation. This number here is the dimension of the moduli space of curves. So in other words, this part of the fundamental cycle comes from the deformation of complex structures of the underlying curve C. Well, this term here coincides with the rank of the vector bundle H0 C F star of Tx minus the rank of H1 C of F star Tx. And this vector space H0 parameterizes infinitesimal deformations. Deformations of the stable map. Well, this vector space H1, the first group, this is the vector space where the abstractions of extending infinitesimal deformations to actual deformations, this is where the abstractions lie. And the construction of the virtual fundamental cycle essentially consists of constructing a vector bundle on the moduli space. Well, intuitively, you can think that the rank of this vector bundle is H1 of the abstraction space. And then you have to construct a cone inside this bundle and intersect with the zero section. So the construction is approximately like this. Okay. And now, once you have these ingredients, then Gromov-Witten invariants are defined as follows. So I'm going to write them as correlators. And they'll depend on T and Q on a point in the cohomology and the Novikov variables. And it's the following formal power series. So we sum over all effective curve classes. We sum over all L from 0 to infinity. Then q to the d divided by L factorial. And then we integrate against the virtual fundamental class, cycle, and then we integrate the following cohomology classes, psi 1 to the k1, psi n to the kn, and then we pull back via the evaluation maps alpha 1 find tensor t to dl, where psi I is the first term class of this line bundle Li, and alpha I and T are cohomology classes. Right. So this is what the Gromov-Witten invariant is. I will denote it for short with GW, Gromov-Witten. And now let me also recall that there is a so-called divisor equation for every insertion corresponding to a divisor class, there is a rule how to simplify the correlator, and it could be written in this way. So if you take the derivative with respect to a divisor variable, then you get qi ddqi, and here the correlator is absolutely the same insertion, so let me just write it like this, and then the rest is sum over all, sorry, let me write it, the sum is over all s, where s is between 1 and n, and Ks is greater than 0. And then you have the following correlator, alpha 1 psi k1, alpha s cup product pi, psi to the ks minus 1, alpha n psi to the kn, gn tq. This is the divisor equation, and the reason I recall this divisor equation is because it allows you to conclude that the so-called primary invariants, these are Gromov-Witten invariants in which all these k, these powers of the psi classes are zero, so no descendant insertions. So these primary invariants, they're actually formal power series in the following variables, in T1, Q1 e to the T2, QR e to the TR plus 1, TR plus 2, etc., T capital N. In order to get a Frobenius manifold, we need to make a convergence assumption. I think that actually I don't know a single example where it is known that the primary, I want to write formal power series, not polynomials, formal power series. I don't know a single examples in which the primary invariants are not convergent. There are many examples where it's known that they are, whether it's not known whether they are convergent, but for example, for all toric manifolds, one can prove that the primary invariants are convergent power series. And recently there was a very interesting paper by D2. He established quite general criteria for convergence of, in the case, the small quantum cohomology is semi-simple for a Fanu variety. In particular, his criteria applies for Fanu variety. And my expectation is that in general, it's always satisfied. But for now, I have to make it as an assumption. So there exists an epsilon greater than zero, such that, so given, so there is, exists an epsilon greater than zero with the following property. Let us define M to be, it's some kind of a poly disk. So all T, yeah, so this is in the cohomology of our manifold, that satisfy the following inequalities. So T1 is less than epsilon, Qi e to the Ti plus 1 is less than epsilon for all I between 1 and R. And finally, Tj less than epsilon for, right? So we define this kind of poly disk. And then the assumption is that all primary invariants are convergent power series for T in M. I guess in my assumptions, in the beginning, I fixed the Novikov variables to be formal variables, but here you just choose some values of the Novikov variables. You assign to them some complex numbers in an arbitrary way, and then you consider your manifold M to be of this type. Right. And so this is the assumption, and now if you have this convergence, so if you have this convergence assumption, then you can define a Frobenius manifold in the following way. So first of all, the tangent bundle of M is naturally trivialized using the linear structure of the vector space, right? So the vector field DDTA is identified with the cohomology class phi A. And now using this identification, then we can define a non-degenerate bilinear pairing on the tangent bundle just by using the Poincaré pairing. And we define a multiplication. This is what is called quantum cup product. So it's just this three-point correlator. Zero, three. So this is called quantum cup product. Then the unit vector field is just the identity. Right. The Euler vector field is going to be the following vector field. 1 to n degree. I plus C1 of Tx. This formula for the Euler vector field follows essentially from the dimension, from the formula for the degree of the virtual fundamental cycle. And here by complex degree, I mean that if phi I belongs to h2k of xc, then we define the complex degree to be k. Right. And let me also give you a formula for the grading operator. Theta phi I is equal to d over 2 minus degree c phi I times phi I. I think I forgot to say when I gave you the formula for the degree of the virtual fundamental cycle, but this capital D is the dimension of the manifold, the complex dimension of the manifold. And then the main theorem, in Gromov-Witten theory, is that if, well, not in Gromov-Witten theory, in genus zero Gromov-Witten theory, is that if the genus zero primary Gromov-Witten invariants are convergent, then this data that I just introduced, M, the quantum cup product, the Poincaré pairing, the unit, and the Euler vector field is a Frobenius structure of conformal dimension, D. In this case, just by definition, the flat coordinates are just the linear coordinates on the cohomology. So they are very easy to find. And now, in Gromov-Witten theory, actually this theorem follows easily from another theorem that I want to state now, which has some quantity which will be important for me. Namely, it's what is called calibration. So let me explain what is calibration in Gromov-Witten theory. Suppose that we are, so I'm here, I'll be in the settings, in the settings of Gromov-Witten theory. So this is just, the calibration is just a power series operator power series of this form. Or matrix power series, where the coefficients are endomorphisms of H, so linear operators in H, such that, so they are defined by the following formula, SKTQ. Applied to phi A. In order to define the value of the linear operator on this vector, it's sufficient to tell you, since the Poincaré pairing is non-degenerate, it's sufficient to define how it pairs with every vector in the cohomology. And the definition is the following. It's just this two-point correlator, phi A psi to the k minus 1, phi B 0, 2, T Q. And actually, this kind of operator series, I don't have time to explain it in my lectures. You can look, for example, in the paper of Giventhal, quantization of quadratic Hamiltonians. This series actually determines all genus zero Gromov-Witten invariants. So just knowing this series S of TQZ, you can determine all other Bromfuitan invariants. Okay, so here this definition is for all A, B between 1 and N, and K is greater or equal than 1. So now let us denote also by a row the operator of classical cup product multiplication by the first Chern class. This is a nilpotent operator. Note that it satisfies the following commutation relation. Theta commutator with rho is equal to minus rho. Let me recall you again that theta is essentially minus the degree operator, right? And since the complex degree of the first Chern class is 1, that's why this you get minus rho, right? So that's easy to see. And now the theorem is the following. The series S satisfies the following conditions. First of all, it satisfies what is called symplectic condition, and I'll talk about this later on in my lectures. So S of T Q minus Z transpose times S of T Q Z is equal to 1. And part B, the following matrix valued function. So it's S of T Q Z, Z to the theta, Z to the minus rho, is a solution to the structure connection. In other words, in more details, this means that Z d dt A of Y, right, T Q Z for all A between 1 and N. And then in the Z direction, the differential equation looks like this. Theta. And here in the first condition, so let me just say a remark. If you have an endomorphism, a linear operator, in H, then we define the transpose of A by, this is just transposition with respect to the Frobenius pairing. And now this theorem implies theorem one, because if this connection has a, if this system of differential equation has a solution, since our S matrix starts with the identity matrix, you can see that the columns of this matrix Y give you linearly independent solutions of this system. And therefore the system must be compatible, which is exactly what it means for the connection to be flat. So therefore this theorem two, this is how you prove theorem one, you prove theorem two. And theorem two is proved using what is called genus zero recursion, topological recursion relations in Gromov-Witten theory. So it's some standard identities in Gromov-Witten theory. But now I want to finish my lecture actually with I want to use this example as a motivation to give the following definition. I want to say that a Frobenius manifold is said to be calibrated if now the first condition that I'm going to impose it's not really necessary, but these two examples from Gromov-Witten theory and from singularity theory, they all have this condition, so that's why I decided to introduce it. So first I want to assume that the grading operator is diagonalizable. Diagonalizable with rational eigenvalues. And the second condition is that there exists a nilpotent operator rho let me denote the Frobenius okay maybe the Frobenius manifold is M. Well, here H means one of the tangent spaces, so you can just choose a reference point in your Frobenius manifold. So here. So T0 will be a reference point. So there exists a nilpotent operator such that theta commutator with rho is minus rho and the structure connection del has a solution of the type y of tz equals s of tz z to the theta z to the minus rho where s of tz equals 1 plus sum k equals from 1 to infinity sk of t z to the minus k where each coefficient is a linear operator in H and this series satisfies the symplectic condition. This is the end of the definition, and it can be proved that maybe I can write a remark that if condition one is satisfied, so if the grading operator is diagonalizable, is satisfied. That is right. Then the calibration exists. Then the calibration exists. Actually, yes. Even if you omit the first condition, you can still prove the existence of a calibration, but then this condition here becomes more complicated. So the nilpotent operator might have other terms that could have several components. Something like rho should be replaced with sum over rho k, and the commutator with theta rho k is minus k rho k. So somehow here this condition becomes more complicated. But as I said, in the examples in geometry, they all have this kind of calibration. So I want to say that, so I want to assume that my Frobenius manifolds admit such a choice, that we can choose a nilpotent operator and construct a solution of the structure connection of this form, satisfying the symplectic condition. Okay, I still have 14 minutes left, and then I'm not sure whether now it's a good time for me to stop, although I could continue a little bit more with the lecture from tomorrow, but maybe I should leave it, maybe I should stop now and leave the remaining time for questions or comments.
Okay.
I guess for today I talked a little bit faster because I assume that these topics are known to many people. So
okay. Thank you very much. Okay. So let's leave for question.
Yeah. Okay.
I have very elementary question. Why dimension of the tangent fiber of tangent space is the same as cohomology? TM is equal to H.
Yes. So you see this example, this is the definition of H. So in the case of quantum cohomology, M is an open subset of H.
Okay.
Oh, and I then see. the tangent space is automatically the same as H.
Yeah, I see.
But in the abstract setting of a Frobenius manifold, we choose one point T to be a reference point, some T circle.
Okay.
And then H then would be this tangent, this reference tangent.
Oh, sorry. I mixed up M and X. Sorry. Sorry.
Yeah. All right.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, I guess for today probably it is more I lecture about known things. So.
There is maybe a question.
So in LG setting or FGRW setting, what is the rule?
In the settings of FGRW theory.
Yeah, is there a rule here? The rule is the multiplication.
FGRW theory, what would be a rule? I know when it's when you take the mirror in the singularity theory, right? So when the mirror comes from a singularity theory, usually this H, let me write with blue. So if you have a singularity F, right? So some holomorphic function. So for FGRW theory, you just take a polynomial, right? Some invertible polynomial, for example. Mm-hmm. But anyways, I know in singularity theory what it is. So in this case, the space, the role of H in this case is played by the Jacobi algebra, of the local algebra of this function.
Okay.
5. And then the role of rho is played by the class of the function f. So multiplication by f defines a nilpotent operator here. Right. And what is, so in general, FGRW theory, well, if you take FGRW theory with the maximal group of symmetries of the polynomial, it will be mirrored to such a Frobenius manifold that comes from singularity theory. And on the mirror side, that would be the rho operator. But in FGRW side, I'm not quite sure how to define a rho.
In Gromov-Witten setting, the multiplication is not the quantum product, it's just the Urey product.
Right. And here it's here the pro, so in general, you have to consider a universal deformation, right?
Then F it is the quantum.
Okay. TIFI, I equals from 1 to n. So here these phi I are a basis of the local algebra. And then the Frobenius manifold is just the space of deformation parameters.
Oh, so you mean that this rho is just a multiplication of F in the Jacobi ring of universal deformation?
Yeah, so somehow you identify, now the tangent spaces here are identified with the Jacobi algebra of the universal deformation F. Uh-huh. And somehow when you specify t to zero, right? So the Euler vector field in this picture would correspond to the function f here. And now if you remember in Gromov-Witten theory, this rho comes when you specify t1 and all variables t to zero, right? So it was the constant part of the Euler vector field. And here also, if you specialize to t equals zero, to the actual singularity, right? Not to the most singular point, then this Euler vector field will be specialized to rho. But in Gromov-Witten theory is a little bit more complicated. So this quantum cup product, this classical cup product, it's a limit of the quantum cup product, but you have to take the limit when the non-equal variables go to zero. And somehow this is a very tricky limit because if you remember the quantum cup product, the structure constants, they depend on qi e to the ti plus 1. So therefore, taking the limit when qi goes to 0 simply means that the real part of ti plus 1 goes to minus infinity. So somehow, in order to obtain the classical cup product from the quantum cup product, you have to take some limit towards a point which is not on the Frobenius manifold. Well, in singularity theory, it's much easier to... So this limit, this kind of classical limit, this point is on the Frobenius manifold. And that's why, in general, it's very hard to define this operator rho. Because you have your Frobenius manifold, you have some nice multiplication, etc. But in order to define this operator rho, you have to take Frobenius multiplication by the Euler vector field and take some kind of limit which is towards a point on the boundary of the Frobenius manifold. And it's very tricky to do it. So that's why I put it as a part of the definition. So I postulated the existence of such an operator, right? And in general, one can study. Actually, my student Chen Han Zha, he studied the most without the assumption that theta is diagonalizable. He classified all possible choices of a calibration in such a nilpotent operator, which satisfied the second condition. And we found that there is some unipotent group acting on such pairs of this calibration S and the nilpotent operators. So there is no really a canonical choice. You really have, if you, in the abstract settings of a Frobenius manifold, so you have to make a choice. In general, there is no natural choice. And in FGRW theory, I'm not quite sure whether how to make this choice of row.
Is this row possible to be zero?
Sorry?
The row in FGRW, is this row possible to be zero?
Right. So if your polynomial satisfies a Calabi-Yau condition, so if it's quasi-homogeneous polynomial, then it will be zero. So as you can see here, if the polynomial is weighted homogeneous, then f would be zero in the local algebra, so rho becomes zero. And this is somehow is the Calabi-Yau condition that the first Chern class, in the Calabi-Yau case, the first Chern class of the tangent bundle is zero, so this rho is zero.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, yes.
Any other questions? So I have a very elementary question. What is the role of Euler vector field? Is it appears in these connections and also this grading operator?
So the Euler vector field is it records some kind of a homogeneity condition of the Frobenius structure. So somehow, if you rescale the these parameters t, then the structure constants rescale in a controlled way, and it's some conformal invariance of of the Frobenius structure.
I see.
So. And it will show up, actually, this Z direction is very important of the structure connection. In some, actually, you can think of the entire Frobenius, when you have an Euler vector field, you can think of this structure connection. Let me go back to, where did I write it? Maybe here. Actually, you can think this is the most important part of the connection, right? The one the rest could be viewed as an isomonodromic deformation of this.
I see.
So there are examples. For example, if you study K-theoretic Gromov-Witten theory, where you lose the grading and you don't have this last condition. But then, much less is known, right? So this Euler vector field, at least for me, it will play a very important role.
I see. Why is it called Euler vector field?
Because I wrote it in Gromov-Witten theory. I wrote it like. Here,
yeah,
I think that in general, this kind of grading. So essentially, if you have a function which is an eigen function for E, what does it mean? It means that if you assign to the variable ti degree 1 minus degree of phi, right, this degree, then your function would be homogeneous of degree. Right? And I think classically this was called Euler vector field.
Right? I see. Okay. Right. Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay, it looks like I was going faster than I was planning. So maybe tomorrow I could try slower, or I could just try to include more.
Okay, it's up to you.
I see, okay.
Okay, Bert, thank you very much. Let's thank the Todor by whatever method. Thank you very much. So I will stop the recording.